Hello everyone. Today we are going to host the talk of Professor Andrea Staiti. Andrea Staiti is a distinguished visiting professor at the University of Boston, and he started teaching recently at the University of Parma. He's going to introduce us to the very
Boston College, to be precise.
Right, sorry, Boston College, right. And today is going to introduce us to the very interesting topic of the Universalis. So we'll still be talking about phenomenology of religious experience on a slightly more technical level. This discussion will be followed as usual by a Q&A session in another video. Now I'll give you the floor to Professor Staiti, and thank you, Andrea, for being here and giving this talk today.
Thank you, Susie. It's a pleasure to be here. It's a pleasure to be able to share some of my recent work. So let me begin maybe just following up on what Susie was saying about, you know, going into a slightly more technical topic here. So when Susie invited me to give a webinar, or, you know, whatever it's called in this series, she was telling me that, you know, the overarching theme is religious experience. And even though I am very interested in the philosophy of religion, and I have very good friends who are specialists also in the field, I would be a liar if I said that I am myself a specialist in philosophy of religion. I am, at best, I would say, an eager kind of interested reader of topics in philosophy of religion. But then, as we were kind of discussing, you know, what could I contribute to this project, I thought maybe it wouldn't be too far-fetched, or it wouldn't be too kind of irrelevant to talk a little bit about the topic of universals in phenomenology. This is because, first of all, it's a traditional topic in philosophy. I mean, it's something that it's an issue, you know, what are universals, how are they related to particulars, how do we cognize them, what's the status of our cognition of universals, how do we justify claims about universals, you know, vis-a-vis claims about particulars. You know, these are issues that are as old as philosophy itself. So in one sense, you know, whatever kind of specialized field of philosophy we're interested in, there are perennial topics that are relevant, you know, to, I think, philosophy as a whole. But second, also, I think, because as those of you who are familiar with ancient philosophy, medieval philosophy already know, that the issue of universals and, you know, what we think about universals has a bearing also on, you know, what we think about what we are as a soul, right? What we are sort of beyond or over and above our physical existence, and also what we think about truth, what we think about, you know, the reach and the kind of, we could say, the value or the status of the kinds of truths that we are able to attain. So it is no surprise that, for example, at the very dawn of philosophy with Plato, the contemplation of the forms, so the contemplation of the ideas, was itself, I would say, a religious kind of experience. It was a religiously laden kind of experience. It was not just a, you know, a dry academic enterprise, but it was something that, you know, was supposed to be transformative, was supposed to, you know, lead the philosopher out of the cave and reshape, redefine their life in light of ideals, in light of, you know, universals. So it's interesting that, you know, if you fast forward, you know, about, let's say, you know, almost two millennia or more than two millennia, actually, the rediscovery, or I would say the rehabilitation of universals and of the cognition of universals in phenomenology through Husserl, besides being a technical topic in the philosophy of knowledge, in the philosophy of cognition and, you know, the philosophy of logic, was perceived by the circle of students who surrounded Husserl in Göttingen as a kind of major turn in philosophy that also had what they called a weltanschauliche Bedeutung, so a meaning or a relevance for the purpose of a worldview. So in other words, you know, Husserl's rehabilitation of universals and, you know, of our ability to cognize them was perceived by his students, by, you know, his closest students, we could say the next generation of phenomenologists, as a philosophical move that had a bearing on, you know, their own worldview and their own, we could say, spiritual life. If you read, for example, in Edith Stein, she says very clearly that for them, for her generation of students, Husserl's logical investigations were perceived as a rediscovery of realism, and so the rediscovery of, you know, the possibility of truth, of cognizing something like a solid, robust truth in an age that they perceived as primarily dominated by subjectivism, or, you know, kind of potentially skeptical tendencies in the conception of knowledge. Another example of this trend, or, you know, this perception of Husserl's rehabilitation of universals as a transformative experience, as, you know, something that had a bearing on, you know, Husserl's students' religious life or kind of spiritual life, is, we could say, maybe a somewhat more odd or unusual piece of writing. It's a book written by one of his most devout students called Dietrich Manke, who was also a soldier in the Great War. And he wrote this little book, which of course is rhetorical, and, you know, it's also kind of rife with the kind of German nationalism of the time. But, you know, if we try to separate the wheat from the chaff a little bit, I think it's an interesting book. It's called Der Wille zur Ewigkeit, so The Will to Eternity. And what Manke says in this little book is that for him as a student, kind of listening to Husserl, who was kind of, you know, articulating this view of the world where, you know, besides cognition and intuition of particulars, we also have knowledge of eternal essences, and that knowledge is accessible to us. It can become, you know, the subject matter of a philosophical science. He says that for him, this kind of experience of contemplating eternity, sort of eternal values, eternal validities, was an invigorating experience, also in the kind of misery of the trenches, in the miseries of the war. The kind of training he had received in phenomenology, this awareness that, you know, our knowledge and, you know, our, say, will to know cannot be exhausted just by our sensory experience. So this kind of Platonism of sorts, of course, we would need a lot of qualifications to do justice to Husserl's actual theory, but just to say that it was immediately perceived as something that elevated the soul, elevated the spirit to a kind of knowledge that had an impact on how, you know, Husserl's students saw the world. So this is just to say at the very beginning, even though in a moment I'm going to be talking about slightly more, like Susie said, technical issues, I think that, you know, this might be an interesting thing to keep in mind as we kind of sketch out some of Husserl's ideas on universality and, you know, universals, that, you know, if we try to really think through the implications of a philosophical theory that emphasizes, you know, the possibility to cognize universals, there are all sorts of resonances and all sorts of implications for that, that I think can also be made fruitful and can also be relevant for something like a philosophy of religion. Now, maybe this might be something for more discussion, you know, when we have our Q&A session eventually. And so let me start by saying a few words about the approach. So what I'm going to do today is I'm going to look at the way that Husserl appropriated a certain notion of universality from a philosopher of the mid too late, I would say, so mid to late 19th century, whose name is Hermann Lotze. And he is almost unknown today, but he used to be perceived as, you know, the most important German philosopher of the time. In fact, all of his work, or I'd say a good 90% of his writings are translated into English. So they were translated right away after they were published in German. And he was widely read in places like Great Britain. So he was a major source of inspiration for some figures in so-called British idealism. He was very much read and appreciated also across the pond in the US. For example, just as an anecdote, George Santayana, who you probably all know as an important intellectual at the beginning of the 20th century in Boston, wrote his dissertation on Lotze, and Lotze was a major kind of point of reference for people like Josiah Royce and, you know, the transcendentalists and, you know, the whole kind of idealist movement in the Boston area. So just to say that, you know, we're talking about a philosopher who really had a major impact on the culture of his time and also on Husserl. And I think the reason for that is a very interesting and, in my opinion, a very kind of plausible, convincing idea about universality that he presents and that I'm going to talk a little bit about today. So maybe just one more word. Those of you, I mean, if you, anybody had a chance to glance over at least, you know, some of the things I've been working on, you might be aware of the fact that my students certainly know that I often emphasize the necessity to read Husserl in context. So to be aware of the kinds of conversations that he was part of in his time, and that makes his work so much more intelligible and so much more interesting, I think, than just reading him as a solitary philosopher, sort of philosophical giant who was just, you know, thinking to himself, and because he was not. I mean, he was deeply conversant with the major figures and kind of major currents of philosophy in his time. And so I think what I'm about to describe is an instance of you know, how important it is to keep in mind the sorts of influences and the sorts of debates that Husserl was responding to and was trying also to kind of carry forward, right, in his own work. Okay, so what is this notion and, you know, what is this idea in Lotze that I find so important or interesting? Well, it's the distinction that Lotze makes in one of his major works called Logic, between what he calls first and second generality. Now, I translate the word in German is Erstes und Zweites Allgemeine. So the reason why I prefer to translate generality as opposed to universality in this case is because Lotze's point is precisely that our first encounter with generals, we could say, so with general entities, with, you know, we could say non-particular entities, is precisely not an encounter with universals in the sense of concepts or in the sense of, we could say, ideas, if, you know, we want to be more Platonic in the formulation. But it's a quite distinct, it's a quite different sort of entity, which is, of course, not a sensory, kind of strictly speaking, a sensory entity, but it's also not a concept, not, you know, a universal in the kind of received sense of the term. So that's why I prefer to translate generality here, because, you know, generality admits of degrees, right? You know, something can be more or less general. And and most importantly, you know, I'm interested in precisely this notion that we have in the very word in German, which is allgemein, so something that is common to all, right? But, you know, depending on how many entities, you know, we are considering, you know, what's the range or, you know, what's the kind of multiplicity over which our general entity is supposed to range? So depending on that, we will have different forms of generality and hence, you know, a distinction between first and second generality. So what is this all about? Well, first of all, in order to appreciate the importance of this notion, we have to briefly recall, you know, the reason why Lotze is remembered, if he is remembered at all today, which is the notion of validity. So those of you who are a little bit familiar with late 19th century, early 20th century German philosophy may know that the word Geltung or Gültigkeit, which is all the cognate phrases here, were very prominent. And they were used, they were technical terms, used to define the kind of reality that attaches to ideals and ideas in general. So for example, you know, we could say of the principle of contradiction that it has Geltung, that it has validity, it's valid, right? So the philosopher who first employed that term and brought it to, we could say, prominence in the philosophy of this period is precisely Lotze. More specifically, you know, this was introduced in the context of his own idiosyncratic reading of Plato. In fact, Lotze had this very interesting way of reading Plato by saying that, you know, the forms in Plato's work should not be. And in fact, he thought that Plato, in one sense, misunderstood himself. But they should not be read or understood as beings. So they are not the sorts of things that exist or fail to exist. But their reality entirely coincides with their validity. So for them, we could say, to be is to be valid. You might be a bit puzzled. You might think that sounds a bit weird. It's true that it sounds a bit more weird in English than it does in German. But think of it this way. For example, take any, say, mathematical relation, right? If I say 2 plus 2 equals 4. So we could ask, you know, does this relation exist? Does the relation 2 plus 2 equals 4 exist? Well, I think Lotze would say this question would be out of place here. So the question about the relation 2 plus 2 equals 4 is not whether or not it exists and where it exists. The question is whether or not it's valid, right? We could say whether or not it's true, but, you know, we could say true is the proposition that expresses the relation, right? If I say 2 plus 2 equals 4, well, that's a proposition. It has a truth value, and it's true if it, you know, if it matches, you know, some state of affairs, right? Something that is actually valid. So Lotze would say you can extend that perspective on, you know, basically all ideal entities and sort of all ideal relations, right? So the same would hold for Platonic ideas in general. So the idea would be that Platonic ideas, you know, pace Plato in one sense, the point is not that they have being in some kind of separate world, because being is really not the point. The point is that they are valid, that, you know, our thought kind of perceives the forms as compelling in some sense, right? So that whenever I am kind of reflecting on, for instance, my experiences of beauty, if I do so in a kind of philosophically robust way, I will encounter at some point, you know, the compelling force of something like beauty that governs and arranges and structures, you know, my experiences of, you know, this or that particular that I experience as beautiful. So I cannot enter into the details here, but, you know, this view that, you know, the point about ideal relations is not whether or not they exist, but whether or not they're valid, became almost a canonical piece of philosophical knowledge in the late 19th century, in early 20th century. And Husserl himself makes abundant use of the notion, you know, when he talks about pure logic and when he talks about the status of ideas. Okay, so, but I think one of the difficulties here, when we say, okay, so if you look at, you know, the kind of picture of the world that you get from Lotze here, is that, okay, so there is a world of sensory experience, and that's, you know, the sphere of being, the sphere of existence and non-existence, right? And then there is a separate world of ideas in a semi-Platonic fashion, and those do not exist or not exist, but they are either valid or not valid. So one of the things that I think people, even people who are enthusiastic about this distinction, often fail to ask is, okay, but how are these two worlds connected? How do we move from, you know, world one to world two? How do we move from, you know, our encounters with, you know, sensory experience to ideas, right? And validity, or is there any connection, or, you know, do we simply lead a double life in, you know, two distinct worlds, and, you know, there is no reconciliation between the two? So this is where Lotze's theory of first and second generality becomes interesting, because I think this theory is sort of provides an account of how it's possible for us to be aware of, you know, non-particulars in the first place, and therefore kind of enter the realm of validity that we subsequently have to explore, right, using our rationality and our kind of logical abilities. So again, to recap, there is this notion of validity that Lotze puts forward in his interpretation of Plato. Validity is, you know, the sphere of reality in which being is not at issue, we could say. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, you know, ideas are supposed to hold valid also for particulars, right? So there is a necessary question about how, you know, the world of particulars in which being or non-being is at issue, and the world of ideas in which being or non-being is not at issue, but only validity and non-validity are at issue. So how are the two connected? So here is, you know, a very basic question. And the theory of first and second generality is Lotze's answer to that question. That's why I think it's an interesting theory. And we will see eventually how Husserl capitalizes on that theory, how he kind of creatively appropriates it, and I think also improves it in an important sense. Okay, so first of all, let me say a few things about Lotze. So the context in which the theory of first and second generality is introduced is the first section of his logic, where, among other things, he's trying to define the task of thinking. So he's trying to explain what is it that we try to do in thought? What is it that thought contributes to our experience that our kind of simple sensory experience does not provide? And his idea is that, you know, the activity of thinking is primarily about distinguishing between presentations, or, you know, Vorstellungen in German, that simply occur together, sort of happen to occur together, and presentations that belong together. Mm. You know, so presentations whose occurrence, you know, in the same stream of experience is regulated or governed by some kind of principle. So the picture here is that, you know, which is of course adapted to empiricism, and in one sense almost repeating, you know, the Kantian gesture. He's trying to take seriously the empiricist challenge, right? You know, all we have is a stream of experiences, and those experiences are fundamentally sensory, right? So how do we, you know, how do we pull out of that stream of experiences something more than just a jumble of data that just happen to occur together? So Lotze would say, well, that's the job of thinking. The job of thinking is precisely to be able to distinguish between, you know, presentations that just occur together, so happen to occur together, and presentations that belong together, and that, you know, presentations for which you can actually exhibit, you know, the ground and the reason for their occurring together. Now, how do we do that? Well, for Lotze, the first thing that we need to do is we need to be able to distinguish between the occurrence of an impression as just a subjective happening, right? Something that happens to me, and the content of that impression. So that which the impression sort of presents us with. So that's what he calls objectification. So think about, you know, you wake up in the morning, you open your eyes and, you know, you see the, for example, the white of the wall in front of you. So at first we could say, well, that's a subjective occurrence. That's something happening to me. Like, you know, this is my sensory experience. And then, you know, you realize, well, wait a minute, there is a wall out there, it's white. So there is a sense in which a separation occurs. Now the white, which at first was just an impression, was just something happening to you, we could say, now it's become something distinct from your impression. Now it's something about the world, right? So that's already one step. We could say these are some of the preliminary steps, you know, in the for the task of thinking. Another step is what he calls positing. So you need to, we could say, not just distinguish, you know, whatever you experience from your experience of it, but you also have to be serious about it. So you have to posit that, you know, there is something out there. And then the third step, which is the most important for the topic of today, is what he calls comparing or comparison. So in other words, we could say that 90% of the work, the task of thinking, really is about comparing, you know, all the sensory materials, you know, that occur in the stream of our experience. And it's only, sorry, through this comparison that we can then raise the question, okay, which ones are the ones that belong together, which ones are the ones that just happen to occur together. So, but now, and this is where, you know, Lotze, after, you know, making this point and saying, you know, comparing is actually, you know, the most important aspect, you know, of the process of objectification, he pauses to consider that, you know, we take it for granted that we can compare different impressions, right? Or to be more precise, we take it for granted that we can compare the contents of different impressions. But if we think about it for a moment, you know, that's not so obvious or irrelevant at all. In one sense, we could say, you know, it's a wondrous fact that, you know, we are able to compare the contents of our presentations. To make his point, Lotze says, you know, that there are, he repeats a kind of popular view that, you know, our language in one sense is a falsification of our experience because, you know, the words that we use are so much more, we could say, coarse-grained, in contemporary idiom, than our sensory experiences. For example, we say blue for a whole variety, a whole spectrum of, you know, different shades of color. And so the point that, you know, this kind of popular view would be to say, well, that's a dramatic simplification of our actual experience. But, you know, Lotze says, well, wait a minute, you know, there could be a world in which that possibility to call blue an entire spectrum of different shades of color might not be possible. So there might be a world in which we would actually need one distinct word for each single shade of color, right? So it's not our world, thankfully. You know, our world is the sort of world in which when we see, you know, 25 different shades of blue, you know, we can say blue. There could be a world in which, you know, we would not only kind of romantically dream of having such a rich language, but, you know, in which we would see 25 different things and, you know, not be able to call them blue, kind of, you know, holding them together as a group. So, as Lotze says, and I'm going to quote briefly, he says, this comparison of the diverse clearly presupposes a common element to which, in the several members of the series, specific differences attach. Such a common element is usually considered by logic only in the form of a general concept. And in this shape, it is a product of more or less numerous acts of thought. It is therefore important to point out that this first generality, which we find here involved in the comparison of simple presentations, is an essentially different kind. That it is the expression of an inward experience which thought has merely to recognize, and that just for this reason, it is an indispensable presupposition of that other kind of generality which we shall meet in the formation of concepts. And of course, the other kind of generality that we shall meet in the formation of concepts is what he calls second generality. So what is he saying here? So what Lotze wants to say is that the remarkable fact about our experience is that, you know, when we see the 25 shades of blue that I was mentioning before, it's not like, you know, they first come forward, you know, as kind of absolutely different. Then we have to engage our conceptual capacities, right? Then we have to kind of whatever, bring to bear our concept of blue on all of them. And you know, it's that concept that we are somehow injecting into the manifold of appearances. And that's why we can kind of see them as belonging together as a group. Lotze here is being, in one sense, very phenomenological in saying, no, those 25 shades of blue, they come forward as a group before we do anything about it in our thought. So either, you know, we want to, as I think some Kantian of kind of the McDowellian breed, you know, might be tempted to do, to say, no, but, you know, our conceptual capacities are already involved, even though we are unconscious about it, or, you know, we have, in order to be able to call that a group of, you know, shades of blue, there has to be some kind of inner working of our conceptuality. Well, that all sounds possible, but on the other hand, we have no experience of it. So we really have to be convinced that this is what's really happening, right? Because no, when I see 25 shades of blue and I see them all together, right? I don't know, on a poster or whatever, they already come forward as a group before, you know, I do anything at the conceptual level. So this is important to keep in mind, and this is what Lotze wants to emphasize. There is a nice point here by a commentator, Robin Rollinger, who says in a nice paper on Lotze that, you know, this is this amounts to the thesis, and I quote, that there are presentations of universals prior to abstraction. So in other words, that our first encounter with universals, or as I would prefer to translate, generalities here, the first encounter does not happen through abstraction. So it's not like, you know, we first encounter 25 different shades of blue, then we abstract, and then we have something like, you know, a general element. But the group comes forward as a group, and therefore we experience something that grounds the belonging together of the group. And at any time we can kind of shift our attention from each member of the group to that common something, right? The common element that grounds the unity of the group. That's the experience of first generality for Lotze. Now, it's important also to point out that for Lotze, not all kinds of generalities are first experienced as first generalities. That's very important. So we could say it's only at the sensory, you know, sort of, it's only a class of very basic kind of general elements, right, that we first experience in this way. So for example, you know, he's very clear that, for example, sweet and warm, or yellow and soft, are, as he puts it, incomparably different. So the generality, for example, sensory quality, is not something that can come forward as a first generality at the level of direct experience. So in other words, you know, I can call both sweet and blue sensory qualities, right? But that doesn't mean that, you know, they come forward as groups, you know, and that sensory quality is a first generality. No, here Lotze is very clear. in order to be able to grasp a generality like sensory quality, I need to do some conceptual work. I need to be able to kind of coordinate these first generalities and try to produce a hierarchy to kind of organize them into hierarchical relations. Now, this is precisely what characterizes, his understanding of concept formation, right? I will not delve too deeply into his theory of second generality, but the idea here would be that, our first encounter with generality, or to rephrase, that, first generalities are ingredients of our experience as much as particulars. And that's a remarkable fact. That's something that thought acknowledges. It's not something that thought kind of creates or kind of initiates. But then once we recognize these first generalities, the task of organizing them into something like a Porphyrian tree or, a kind of conceptually articulated whole, well, that's an additional level of work. That's not something, we do not find, ideas, we could say, or generalities already kind of neatly organized in experience. That's what thought has to do. And it's only through kind of this conceptual and logical reorganization that we encounter then, what he calls second generalities. For example, sensory property, or think about, space filling property, right? That could also be a generality that we do not encounter in direct experience. We have to engage our logical abilities. Okay, so now turning to Husserl, what does Husserl make of this notion, and why is it important for his own understanding of generality? Maybe let me just say briefly one thing about Husserl's actual reception of Lotze. We know that Husserl read Lotze, and that he was he actually wanted to write a section on Lotze in the Logical Investigations, but eventually he never did. Some people speculate that the reason why he didn't is because, as you may know, he was teaching in Göttingen, and that's where Lotze taught for most of his life. In fact, he only moved to Berlin, finally kind of receiving the attention and the kind of recognition that he had always wished, unfortunately just 2 years before his death. So he moved to Berlin and died, so he could never be the Hegel of late 19th century as he was hoping to be. So Lotze was really Göttingen was really a stronghold of Lotzeans. And Lotze was also a trained physician and a psychologist, so there is a whole kind of school of psychology in the Lotzean spirit in Göttingen in Husserl's time. And so apparently Husserl did not necessarily want to, sort of say too much about Lotze because he didn't want to be too critical, right? Yeah, and even though he appreciated a lot of Lotze's work, he also had his own criticism. And so he didn't want to kind of upset his colleagues in Göttingen, also because, at that time he was just a privat docent, so he didn't want to jeopardize the possibility to at some point get a regular position. But again, this is just an anecdote. What we do know, again, is that he read extensively the Logic, right? He also held a seminar on Lotze's Logic in 1912. And it's interesting that there is a transcription of that seminar that was recently discovered among the writings of a Canadian philosopher called Winthrop Pickard Bell. And so the text, it's very thorough, it's a very detailed transcription, and it's about to be edited and published. So it's going to be an interesting document, to assess Husserl's relation to Lotze. And you may also know that for Husserl, one of the tenets of Husserl's phenomenology is precisely this idea that we cannot reduce the unity of ideas or the unity of ideals to the multiplicity of mental acts intending ideas. So for example, we could say, if I say something like, red is a primary color, right? Husserl would argue that, you know, what I'm talking about here is not just, you know, my own experience of, you know, patches of red, right? I'm not talking about all the shades of red that I happen to see in my life. I'm not talking about, you know, red stuff that exists in the world. I'm talking about color red as such. In his language, he would say, I'm talking about the species red. I'm talking about the essence red. And so the statement that says, you know, red is a primary color expresses an eidetic, an essential truth that, you know, is not bound to any kind of kind of factual reality in the world. So we could say, you know, as fallibilist as, you know, we want to be, it's not like, you know, we say, well, you know, red is a primary color as far as we know, but maybe one day as science progresses, we will discover a shade of red, which is not a primary color. You know, that doesn't really make any sense, right? Or again, one of Husserl's favorite examples, which he borrows from Locke, the idea that, you know, every color is necessarily spread over a surface, and, you know, every surface is necessarily necessarily has some kind of color property, that we cannot imagine a surface that is not colored in some way, and we cannot imagine a color that's not spread over some kind of surface. Again, the idea is, you know, well, maybe someday, you know, as science progresses, we'll discover a color that's not spread over surface. You know, that doesn't make any sense, because that statement is not about, you know, the world as we know it. It's about the idea color. And you may also, kind of as a footnote, you know, if you are a Wittgensteinian, you might say, well, actually, when we say stuff like, you know, red is a primary color, what we really mean is, you know, we're giving a definition of, you know, a certain way of using the word red in our language. And, you know, we are articulating one of the rules in the language game in which, you know, the word red exists. Well, again, here the reply, I think, of a phenomenologist would be very similar to the replying to the Kantian that I was saying before, because again, I know what it is to talk about the word red. I can say, you know, the word red is a word in the English language. Here, you know, the intentionality of my statement kind of is targeting the word red. And I know what it is to not be talking about the word red, but to be talking about red. So when I say red is a primary color, I'm not talking about the word red. And, you know, there is nothing in the world that, you know, will convince me that I'm actually talking about the word red, because I know what it is to talk about the word red. I know I can do it if I want to. But if I say red is a primary color, again, don't try to convince me that I'm talking about the word red, because I'm really talking about red, right? So, so the attempt to kind of re-describe what you're actually doing, telling you that, you know, what you think you're doing is not what you're actually doing, and I will explain to you what you're actually doing, well, that's the sort of thing that really upsets phenomenologists, because, you know, like, no, I know what I'm doing. Don't try to redirect, you know, the target of my intentionality. I know what I'm intending. I'm talking about the word red. You know, we can talk about that, but we can also talk about red as such. And and then again, you know, imagine that we are sharing, you know, the view that red is a primary color. We could say the unity of that is expressed by that sentence, and so the relation that the sentence is intending is one, and it stands as one over and against the multiplicity of acts of thinking in which it is intended. So if, you know, five people are, you know, talking about red being a primary color, it's not like, you know, red is a primary color five times. Red is a primary color is one kind of unitary relation. It's an ideal relation, so it's a relation of essence. It can be intended in a kind of indefinite amount of acts of thinking, but it has to be distinguished from each of them. So this is, in very brief compass and in a very kind of oversimplified manner, the result in particular of the second logical investigation, right? But here again, I think also for Husserl, we can ask ourselves, okay, but how is it, you know, what's the relationship between species as defined, for example, in psychological investigation, and the particulars in which, you know, these species are given, or, you know, these species are present, we can say, sensibly to us. Now, it's also very important, I mean, in the second logical investigation, Husserl talks about species. Eventually, he talks about essences, but there is also a kind of ambiguity of the notion of essence. Many commentators and many students of Husserl noticed that, you know, he uses the word essence to talk about different things. And so it's over the course, or it's in the attempt to distinguish, you know, various meanings of the word essence, that Husserl resorts to the same distinction that we find in Lotze, with a slightly different, I think a slightly different twist, but nonetheless, I think, you know, with the same kind of preoccupation, so the same kind of intention. What's the intention? Again, the intention is to say, well, generality is, first of all, an ingredient of our experience. So it's not something that our thought kind of injects into experience. And so the first encounter with generality is the encounter with an element, a dimension of our kind of sensory perceptual experience. So what I'm going to quote, what I'm going to talk about here, and I'm actually more or less done, I will just present some of the distinctions, and then say a few things about pure essences, and then that will be it, basically. One of the things that I find, as an aside, particularly fascinating about Husserl is that he's very aware of the fact that, you know, the word universal, or, you know, the word generality, does not name just one kind of ideal entities, that, you know, there is a whole range of very different phenomena that, you know, are not particulars, and so they belong, or they fall under the category of generality or universality, Allgemeinheit in German, but that we need a much more kind of differentiated theory of, you know, generality in order to really do justice to the complexity of, you know, the sphere of the ideal, of the, say, of the non-particular. This is something I think very distinctively Husserlian. Again, if you think about the philosophical tradition, if you think about, for example, the dispute about the reality of universals in the Middle Ages, basically, you know, the dispute had two poles, right? There are individuals and there are universals, and the question is, how are the two related? Now, I think that a lot of credit goes to Husserl and Lotze, and, you know, a lot of German philosophers of the time, to have shown that, you know, the sort of operating with just these two concepts is not enough. We need to differentiate. There is a whole range of phenomena that we need to be able to distinguish under the heading universal, and it's only through, you know, these distinctions, phenomenological distinctions, that we can then clarify the relationship between, you know, non-particulars, ideals, and particulars in experience. So, first of all, it's interesting to notice that the first meaning of essence that we find in Husserl, basically, and that's something that we find, for instance, in the first chapter of Ideas 1, is the idea that, you know, the essence is what he calls the what content, or, quote, the whole stock of predicables, the internal moments of the object, of the individual. So, in other words, what's the essence, for example, of this glass here? Well, we could say it's the total stock of predicables. So it's the total stock of properties that I could be able to spell out, you know, through the corresponding predications. Of course, you know, it's pretty easy to see that, you know, this would be an infinite set of properties, right? You know, I could delve deeper and deeper into the glass. I could, you know, spell out all of its, I don't know, microphysical properties. So every single particular, we could say, the total stock of predicables that defines its individual essence is infinite. We can name it, right? And we can spell out by way of exemplification at least some of these properties. But we don't need to have like the full list of properties in order to be able to talk about essence in this sense. That's also, you know, what Husserl calls the individual essence, right? So the question here becomes, and then of course the second sense of essence, is the more traditional sense, you know, of general essences. So, you know, the genus, for example, thing, vis-a-vis the things that exist in the world. The genus animal, vis-a-vis all the different animals that exist in the world. So I think that this is, however, so this kind of ambiguity, on the one hand, essence is just the sum total of the properties, right, that define the individual. And on the other, it's a general, it's an ideal object, right, that ranges over a multiplicity of individuals. I don't think it's an equivocal kind of ambiguity in Husserl's terminology. So I think it points toward a real phenomenological issue, which we could say is the following. So what kind of experience allows us to transition from the simple perception of an individual, say, I see this cup, to an awareness of its individual essence, right? So the whole stock of predicables that I was talking about, to an awareness of the lowest species under which it is subsumed. For example, this is a glass, right? And finally, to an awareness of the generic essence under which the object stands. For example, this is an artifact, right? Or, you know, at an even higher level, it's a thing, right? So how do we make these transitions? How is our experience structured so that these transitions are possible? That, you know, we don't have to leap from one world to the other, but, you know, we can transition from awareness of a particular through a series of steps to awareness that eventually, you know, of the highest genus. So first of all, it's interesting to notice that for Husserl, the first encounter with generality, as for Lotze, is the experience of groups of sensations or sort of groups of experiential materials, right, that are already connected by kind of ties of similarity before we turn our predictive conceptual thinking toward them. So there is a quote here where he says, this is from a recent volume of Husserliana on eidetics, which I think is very interesting, and most of the stuff I'm quoting actually comes from there. So Husserl says, whenever I find similarity in connectional consciousness, I can ask what grounds similarity. I can transition from the given sensory similarity to a comparison and to the act of holding together, to a connecting grasp of the relation of similarity, and from there, by way of actual comparison, to a consideration of the actual what of coincidence, of the essences or essential moments thereby coming to coincidence. So we could say that the field of our experience is not, again, just an inchoate jumble of data, but, you know, data come forward already structured, you know, according to relations of similarity and difference and dissimilarity, And this is where, you know, our theoretical gaze can kind of dig in order to unearth and to find, you know, the principles that hold together data that are similar. And that's how, you know, we first encounter something like universals. Now, if you think about this hint or, you know, this this idea, you could ask yourself, okay, what's the most complete experience of a common essence that grounds a multiplicity of data? So what's, we could say, where do we, in what, under what circumstances do we make an actual experience of an individual essence? Now, I think that the experience that we all, it's a very kind of mundane experience, you know, that we all do. And it's the experience of seriality, of series, of, you know, a serial, you know, group of entities. So I think it's very, I mean, that's something that kind of occurred to me as I was, as I went to an exhibition of serial painting, which is a very interesting style. So what do we experience when we when we make the experience of seriality? What we experience is a series of individuals that are perfectly alike in every respect, right? In such a way that they could be interchangeable. So we do not distinguish one from the other. You know, think about, for example, if I'm playing the same tone over and over again on the piano, it's, you know, I keep, you know, pressing the same key, right? So we could say, well, it's the same tone that's being played over and over again, right? But to be precise, it's not the same tone that's been played over and over again, because every time I press the key, there is a new tone, right? What's the same, we could say, it's the individual essence, right, of the tone that keeps being individuated or instantiated in a plurality of kind of serially connected tones. Or think about, you know, I don't know, a series of water bottles that are perfectly identical in every respect. So that, I would say, is definitely our, you know, experiences like this, and, you know, all the possible variations of those experiences are probably, you know, the most, I would say, phenomenologically complete experience of something like individual essences. And now, it's interesting that in the context of, you know, discussing this, Husserl says that this kind of generality, and I'm quoting here, is the first generality in the genuine sense, the generality that we call a concretum, which in turn stands under concrete genera. So that's interesting. So we can say, if you are familiar a little bit with Husserl's terminology, you know that a concretum is basically something that's not a part of something else, right? So we could say every individual existing thing is a concretum. And we could say that the first experience of generality is nothing but the individual itself. Once, you know, the contingency of its individuality has been experienced through the experience, or at least, you know, the envisioning the possibility of serialization, right? So even, you know, encountering, you know, we could imagine, replicas of the same person, right? We can imagine replicas of pretty much everything. And so it's, in that case, it's the concretum itself, the whole stock of predicables that is experienced as repeatable, and hence as something of a generality that is being instantiated, you know, in many different venues. So now maybe you realize why I was hesitant to translate universality here, because, you know, it would be difficult for me, you know, if I'm looking at a series of, I don't know, I don't want to be doing commercials here, but, you know, for the sake of you know, I was having a bottle of Evian water, right? I bought one of those six packs. So you have all the six Evian bottles in front of you, right? And so you experience them as serially connected, right? And so there is something of a general, something general that is being instantiated. That's, you know, the Evian bottle general. So do we want to call that a universal? I don't know. I mean, maybe yes, if we agree on the terminology. But of course, there is something that ranges over a multiplicity of individuals. But in one sense, that's not something like a genus. It's not like, you know, the genus bottle, right? Or the genus artifact. But really is the individuality that's being repeated. So, and that's what Husserl calls first generality here, kind of echoing the Lotzean the Lotzean phrase. Now, but it's also important to consider that for him, it's important that he says in the genuine sense, so it's in the strict sense. And I think it would be phenomenologically incorrect to say that our first kind of our most common, our most everyday experience of generality, you know, is the experience of individual essences, you know, in serially connected individuals. Because, you know, that's kind of unusual. Things tend to be less kind of serial or serially connected. So we could say that, you know, the case of perfect alikeness among individuals is a limit case. In most cases, you know, what we have are individuals that are alike in some respect, right? And they can be alike in some respect, either, you know, in the sense of in respect of one of their moments, so one of their properties, for instance, two different things that have the same size or a similar size, or they can be similar in respect to their kind. So, you know, I can play a tone on the piano and then, the same tone on a trumpet. And, you know, it's the same tone. So it's similar in that respect, right? But of course, you know, it's not a serial experience, like, you know, the same tone being played over and over again. Now, Husserl calls the essence that grounds the similarity, you know, this experience of similarity in some respect, that's what he calls concrete generality or concrete essence. And it's interesting that, later in the text that I'm looking at here, he says the concrete essence is the first generality, it's the lowest level of generality. And then he says, and the individual essence is an instantiation of a concrete essence. So he's kind of changing his mind. He's not really changing his mind. He said that individual essence is the first generality in the genuine sense. So in the most strict possible sense, of course. But the first for us, the first in the more common sense, of course, is concrete essences. And those come to expression, you know, with most of our nouns, you know, the nouns that we use in common speech. When we try to answer the question, you know, what is this or that? This is a bottle, this is a cup, this is a friend, you know, and so forth. So now it's important that, you know, concrete essences have an important role in the relationship between the world of particulars and, you know, the world of generalities, because, as Husserl points out, concrete essences are the only essences that are capable of individualizing themselves directly in individual essences. What does that mean? Well, we could think about of it this way. If we start with a generic essence, right, which is not a concrete essence in the sense that I'm describing here, for instance, animal, right? We could say the essence animal cannot instantiate itself directly. In order to instantiate itself, first it has to differentiate itself into its species. So it has to be kind of specified into something like man, horse, cat, whatever. Those are the concrete essences that then can be individualized. You know, they can instantiate themselves in individual essences. So how does Husserl describe this? Well, he says that this is because concrete essences have, we could say, two aspects to them. There is a qualitative and a quantitative aspect. And I mean, this is a little bit technical, but you know, I will I'll skip some of this. But the idea is that it's precisely the quantitative aspect, or you know, the quantitative dimension of concrete essences that kind of carries or supports the individuation. And the qualitative aspect is co-individuated, you know, together with the quantitative aspect. Maybe an example would be a apropos, and again, I'll simplify a little bit. If you think about the essence triangle, for example, right? Well, that would be a generic essence. In order to then become individuated, right? First of all, it has to specify itself into something like, I don't know, you know, equilateral triangle, scalene triangle, obtuse triangle, and so forth. But now, if I take equilateral triangle, right, and I add a specification, you know, a determination of its quantitative component, for example, if I say equilateral triangle whose side is, I don't know, 3 inches long, well, that kind of, you know, specification, it's not a specification, but we can say that indication of, you know, the size, right, of one of its sides. Well, at that point, the triangle is no longer just an essence, but a concrete essence, but it's an individual essence. So we could say an equilateral triangle whose side is 3 inches long, right, it's an individual essence that can now be instantiated in an open multiplicity of individuals. But it's no longer a concrete essence. I mean, it's already an individual essence. Whereas triangle, you know, in order to become something that can be instantiated in individual essence, first of all, needs to be specified. Okay, so now let me conclude maybe with just a couple of remarks about, you know, how do we move from there, from concrete essences to generic essences? And then how do we move, you know, what does this have to do with the, you know, the talk of pure essences that we often find in Husserl? So first of all, it's very interesting that for Husserl, the way in which we move up, we could say, we ascend the scale of genera, again, it's not by comparing different concrete essences, but for Husserl, as he puts it, it's by leaving indeterminate and freely variable some of the concrete essences predicables. In other words, how do we move, for example, from the concrete essence rectangle triangle or scalene triangle to the generic essence triangle in general? For example, is by leaving freely variable, right, so indeterminate, the size of the angles, right? Mm-hmm. So if I decide that, you know, so a triangle in general, we could say it's not kind of an additional, if you think about, you know, the old Humean critique of Locke, you know, what's a, you know, a triangle that's neither scalene nor isosceles nor equilateral, I mean, that doesn't make any sense, right? It's not an additional, I don't know, picture in your mind. But how do we get to the notion of triangle in general? Well, Husserl would say it's not, again, by comparing all the triangles and trying to look for something that they have in common, but it's by variabilization, I think is the word, of, you know, for example, the angles, right? I'd say I'm not, you know, I will not determine the angle or, you know, one of the angles as being 90 degrees or less than 90 degrees or more than 90 degrees. I'll just leave that kind of as a free variable. And it's by sort of variabilizing all, you know, components of concrete essences that we ascend and we get to the kind of more generic essences. And here, again, there is an interesting overlap with Lotze, because that's exactly the way that Lotze accounted for, you know, moving from first generalities to second generalities. And I have a quote from Lotze here that I want to read when he says, quote, this is from the lectures on logic, so not from the logic book, when he says, the ordinary theory of logic is accustomed simply to teach that from comparable individual ideas, notiones specialis, we ascend to the more universal one, notio generalis, by abstracting from the unlike marks of the former and retaining only the like ones. So this theory adds the statement, therefore, that the content of a general idea is poorer, that is, can count fewer marks than that of the particular ones out of comparison of which it arose. So what does that mean? Again, the idea would be, if you consider, and I hear, you know, the language he uses is that of ideas, but you could say essence, right? So, because he's kind of using the terminology of, you know, traditional scholastic logic. So the idea would be, what's the difference between, for example, the idea of metal vis-a-vis the idea of gold? Each idea is defined in terms of its marks, right? Note in Latin. And on kind of on a traditional account of the difference between, you know, a higher, more abstract idea and a more concrete idea like gold and metal, the idea would be that, well, gold has more marks than metal, right? So it has more, we could say, distinctive traits, you know, marks that kind of enter into the definition of the idea. Metal is poorer in content. So in order for something to count as gold, it has to have more features, right, than it needs to have in order to count as metal. Now, Lotze is criticizing this idea, and he says the foregoing remark must at all events be improved upon to this extent that each universal has exactly so many marks which it is indispensable should be thought together as belong to the individuals corresponding to it. Nevertheless, while all these marks are perfectly defined in the particular or in the individual idea, as respects both kind and quantity, in the universal, certain general or undefined marks have taken the place of many of them. The universal idea, as compared with a particular idea, is therefore poorer in defined marks, but not poorer in marks in general. What does that mean? Well, here the idea would be that, you know, the idea of metal has exactly as many marks as the idea of gold, except that, you know, in the idea of metal, there is a bunch of marks that are left kind of freely variable, that, you know, are not being kind of defined. For example, you know, we know that gold has to have a particular color. It has to be yellow, right? But when I'm thinking metal, it's not like metal has, you know, one mark less because, you know, it doesn't necessarily have to be yellow. Of course, a metal has to have a color. But when I'm defining something as metal, when I'm forming the idea of metal, I am leaving the mark color, you know, as a free variable. I'm not kind of fixing it. I'm not putting a definite content to it. So this is very interesting. So the idea is that, you know, how do we ascend the scale of genera? Well, the point is not to try and compare, you know, actually incomparable concrete essences. But it's really this ability that we have to view, you know, any particular mark or any particular property of a certain essence as the specification or as the definition of kind of as the filling of a certain slot, right, that we could also leave freely variable. And once we do that, well, by kind of, you know, orchestrating that relationship between, you know, slots that are filled with a definite content and slots that are left kind of freely variable, that's how we move up and down, you know, the Porfirian tree. Okay, so now let me conclude by saying something about the notion of essence and the notion of pure eidos, you know, that Husserl talks about. So interestingly, we could say as we, you know, as we make this step, right, as we go through this process of variabilizing, so treating as free variables some of the properties of a concrete essence, there is the possibility that we completely leave behind the empirical context of givenness or the empirical ties that bind the essence or that bind an essence to you know, the factual world in which we live. So for example, we could put it this way. So think about a concrete essence. That's an example Husserl himself uses. The example of the essence lion, right? So lion, of course, we can look at this or that particular lion, but we can also look at the concrete essence lion, which is individuated in many individual essences that are carried, or say whose bearers are individually existing lions. Now, Husserl would say, well, we could, when we think about lions, we could try to drop, you know, the reference to the lions that we happen to see, the lions that happen to exist. In his language, you know, we could try to purify the essence lion, right, by dropping what he calls the empirical thesis. So the reference to the factuality of our world. And so he says, you know, in this sense, and this is a quote, lion would be an empirical concept with a thesis and a pure concept without a thesis. Now, the problem is that this doesn't really work for a simple reason that, of course, you know, I can decide to not think, you know, when I say lion and when I form, you know, the concept lion, and so I kind of turn the arrow of my intentionality toward the essence lion, I can decide that I don't want to be focusing on lions that happen to exist or those that I happen to see, those that I will see at some point in my life, or that anybody has ever seen. But I'm just going to talk about lion in general, right? We might say that, I don't know, if I'm writing a treatise of zoology or something like that, you know, that's presumably that's what I'm trying to do. You know, if I write a chapter on lions, probably I'm not talking about this or that lion, I'm talking about lion as such. On the other hand, can we entirely get rid of any reference to the empirical world when we're dealing with an essence like lion? Well, there are reasons to think that this is not really possible, and Husserl himself acknowledges that eventually, right? Why? Well, because if I'm able to think about a definite content at all under the notion of lion, well, that is because, you know, there has been a certain history in the world, or there has been a certain evolution. So there has been a factual, you know, course of natural history that brought about, you know, things like lions. And so, you know, even if, yes, I can, when I'm, I don't know, theorizing about lions, I can make sure that I only say things that apply to lions as such, not just the ones I happen to see. But on the other hand, that tie to, you know, the factual course of natural history, well, that's not something I can simply remove. That's not something that I can drop in thought, because if I really did, you know, I could no longer be able to think about anything about, you know, under the heading lion. So there is this quote, you know, that where he says, empirical concepts are not real specifications of pure generalities. They intend the typical generalities, possible scopes of experience that constantly await new prefiguration from experience. So we could say that, you know, dogs, lions, and trees receive their possible predicables from factual experience. And even when we disconnect the direct empirical thesis pertaining to such essences, it is only by virtue of an implicit empirical thesis that we are able to think something determinate under them. So now I think the interesting question here, and this is again my conclusion, is then the question, you know, what are the essences that we can completely purify and what are the essences that we cannot completely purify? So in other words, there are some essences that once we try seriously to drop any tie to the empirical world, that, you know, they remain where they are. For example, triangle that I mentioned before, you know, that's an essence that I can intend in absolute purity without any reference to the existing world. Well, with lion, it's different. If I start really trying to remove any tie to the empirical world, including the natural history, you know, that brought about lions in the first place, well, then the essence in one sense changes. I am kind of led back in the Latin sense of reductio, right? For example, to the genus. for example, animal, right? So we could say maybe that lions do not have an essence as lions, but they do have an essence as animals. So I, if I'm interested in trying to spell out, you know, the essential necessities pertaining to lions, well, maybe those are the same that pertain to gazelles or to, you know, whatever other animals we might be thinking of. And everything else is more or less empirical. So so I think just here, you know, this is the end of my sketch. You've seen how Husserl has appropriated the notion of first and second generality and, you know, what he has made of it. He has a much more refined, much more robust kind of architecture of, you know, different levels of generality. So let me just conclude briefly. So what I think is that it is Lotze's merit to have drawn a phenomenologically sound distinction between first and second generality, right? We experience first generalities as the ground of relations of similarity found as given in perception. We create or we constitute second generalities in the process of ordering and connecting first generalities. How? Well, by way of considering some of their constituent elements, the note, the marks, as free variables. Husserl retrieves this distinction in his own writings on essence and considers first generalities in the strictest sense to be individual essences, originally given in the experience of seriality and repetition, and in a more liberal sense, concrete essences, that is, essences pertaining to lowest specific differences such as tone or horse. Husserlian second generalities are then the generic essences, so the essences pertaining to higher genera, such as sound or animal. now, here it's important to see, like I said, that, you know, we can always raise the question then, kind of having kind of sketched out this map that leads from a particular to the individual essence, to the concrete essence, to the generic essence. Well, then the question of purity, which is so characteristic of Australian phenomenology, cuts across, we could say, this distinction. And so it's really for Husserl a kind of experimental question to try and figure out, you know, what are the essences that we can really pull out of the empirical factual world, you know, in which we first became aware of them, and which ones are inevitably tied to the empirical world. Okay, so I think I'll stop here. Let me just say that again. I think this is just a sketch, and it's a very, I mean, it's a first attempt to orient myself and hopefully also a little bit my listeners in the intricate world of universals in phenomenology and you know, some of the precursors of phenomenology such as Lotze. And I very much hope that eventually, if there will be a Q&A session, we can kind of deepen a little bit some of the ideas that I tried so kind of, you know, very informally to present this evening. So thanks.
Well, thank you, Andrea, because your talk was very interesting, detailed. I don't know if it's a first attempt. We look forward to the second one. Yeah, and my invitation here is to see how these tools that you are presenting, I mean, this nomenclature, these terms, can work in the description of the religious experience as well. There's a point in which Husserl is somewhat impatient toward the description used by mystics. He defined them lazy sometimes because there's a big hole of information in the experience of the universal, in the sentiment of religion or a contact with something transcendent. And it would be really interesting to avoid the polarity you were describing before, you know, individual, universal. There's a much more detailed number of concepts that we can use to crack this experience that it will be interesting to see how and where it goes. Anyway, sure. I look forward to our next session and the discussion of it. And I thank you, meanwhile, for this beautiful lecture.
Thank you.
Thanks.